This is an emulator for the Nintendo Entertainment System running entirely within Portal 2. Now, I'll state the obvious. It's barely managing 2 frames per second, and at this quality and performance, most sensible people would consider this unplayable. Nonetheless, what's important is that it is running, and it's programmed entirely with the scripting language of Portal 2. But before we talk about what this is and how it came to be, let's quickly cover what this isn't. If you frequent the Portal 2 workshop, you may have come across chambers where people attempt to create a simple computer using logic gates built out of lasers. Indeed, Portal 2's testing elements are Turing complete, which means that, in theory, they can be used to compute anything. But just like real computers are limited by their physical hardware, in reality, you can't construct an NES with this alone. Put simply, the Source Engine has a certain budget for the maximum entity count. No, not a monetary budget, though, hold on, money might actually be a decent analogy for this. Say we start with $2,048. This isn't an arbitrary number, by the way. It's the networked entity limit in most Source games. Exceeding this number instantly crashes the game, so you can think of this as a finite budget for the construction of each test chamber. Every element you place and every connection you make costs you some of that budget. While a simple logic gate is perfectly reasonable, a system on the scale of the NES quickly gets way too expensive. Even if we use cheaper parts, so to speak, by building our own testing elements, we're still not even close to the right ballpark. The cost of a single element cannot be a fraction, as remember, under the hood, this budget is an entity count. That's a discrete, undivisible natural number, so in our analogy, that means that the cheapest possible element costs $1. Anything we build has to consist of less than 2,000 discrete parts. The NES has 8 kilobytes of program memory. That's over 8,000 individual bytes, or about 64,000 bits. So even just the memory alone takes up 32 times our budget, and that's before we even get to the processor. The 6502 was generally considered to be a pretty well-optimized CPU, and by today's standards it's considered ancient, but even that thing has about 3,500 transistors. That's already almost double our budget. But it gets worse once you realize that one transistor requires several puzzle elements. The actual complexity of a chip isn't this cut and dry. You might be able to represent whole logic gates or circuits with less Portal 2 elements than transistors, but unless you're up for the task of re-engineering the 6502 with no breathing room, that's not happening anytime soon. Even if you somehow got a one-to-one copy of the physical CPU running in Portal 2, your next immediate issue would be performance. Portal 2 runs at 60 ticks per second, which means that you can only simulate 60 connections per second. That's like if electricity moved in slow motion. We're no longer talking in frames per second, we're talking CPU cycles per minute. So, okay, now that that's out of the way, how does this work? Well, luckily, Portal 2 has a very powerful built-in scripting engine that lets you write code to automate many scripted events. In the past, I've used VScript to make whole entire gameplay mods, but this time we're looking to port an emulator to it. There are tons of great emulators out there, but we just need one that's really easy to port. So, I chose smallness. Now, okay, hear me out. Some of you might call me an idiot for this, and others might see this as even more impressive. Personally, I just think I shot myself in the foot, but managed to hit a backflip while doing so. See, smallness is an example of code golfing. It's an attempt to achieve the shortest possible source code while still having a functioning program. The final minified version of smallness is under 5,000 bytes of C code. Of course, I won't be working with this version, it's completely unreadable. I'll be working with deobfuscated code, which is slightly better. Even so, various nasty hacks are employed to make the code as small as physically possible. If you're not a programmer, this is kind of like reading a poem written in emoji. You have to really sit down and process every line to understand what it even means. This is why it might seem like a bad choice for a port. The code isn't easy to read, it compromises efficiency for a shorter program, and I can see it being a pain to debug. That said, it being tiny does mean that there's just less code overall to port, and since I understand C better than the NES, I'll probably have an easier time porting a bit of gibberish than trying to understand the codebase of a larger emulator. In other words, if given the choice between reading that emoji poem and dissecting the author's life to extract the story that way, unless you're a trained detective, you're probably much better off just translating the damn poem. That now brings up a question. How different is Squirrel, the Portal 2 scripting language, from C, the language that Smallness is written in? Can we map emoji directly to words, or is there a unique structural difference? Smallness uses the C preprocessor define directive for convenience and smaller code size, which Squirrel doesn't have. This basically just tells the compiler to find and replace all instances of a given token with some other tokens. So, in our Squirrel code, we can replicate this by just performing that find and replace chore manually. That part is simple enough. Next, there's the data types. The NES is an 8-bit system, housing an 8-bit processor. So, of course, the emulator uses 8-bit unsigned integers extensively to imitate that behavior. But Squirrel is a much higher level scripting language, and its only integer type is 32 bits wide. If you're not super familiar with these concepts, it might not be immediately obvious why this is a problem. After all, we literally have more bits. How could that be a limitation? Well, it all has to do with what happens if you exceed those 8 bits. On a true 8-bit system, the largest whole number you can physically represent is 255. If you try to add 1 to that, you literally run out of bits to flip, so the value rolls over back to 0. On a more modern computer, we can easily represent values in the billions. So if you add 1 to 255, instead of becoming 0, it'll just increment to 256. This is just one example of how an 8-bit value differs from a 32-bit value. But yes, at the end of the day, this isn't a deal breaker. If we just tell our code to ignore everything after the first 8 bits of an integer, it starts to behave pretty much like an 8-bit value. Adding 1 to 255 will still flip the 9th bit, making it 256. But notice that if we just mask out all the other bits and leave only the first 8, the value is 0. It's a bit easier said than done, of course. This isn't something you can just magically tell the program to do. You have to carefully find every piece of code where a value could conceivably overflow past 8 bits and wrap it in a function that prevents it from doing so. Then come the pointers. To minimize code size, Smallness uses various raw memory pointers that, well, point to a place in the computer's memory, to make it easier to address specific array elements with a smaller code footprint. This is a feature pretty much exclusive to lower-level languages like C, and while it's obviously very powerful, its use is generally frowned upon in larger systems due to how dangerous it can be to handle memory this way. As such, Squirrel doesn't have any support for raw pointers, so that logic has to be rewritten to use regular old array indexes instead. Lastly, Smallness employs an even nastier C language feature called the goto statement. As the name implies, it lets you go to a specific part of the code unconditionally, completely ignoring any preceding control flow. Letting the developer jump around the code like this is a terrible idea for 99% of scenarios, which is why Squirrel, and most sensible languages really, obviously don't support it. To imitate that behavior in a more rational way, I'll have to change up the control flow in some parts, and wrap a bunch of other code in if statements that check whether a goto is being used. Okay, so that's the big picture. There's a lot that has to be changed already, and the odds of introducing a new bug double with every next step. After monotonously skimming through the code to apply all these changes, I unsurprisingly ran into a few compiler errors, but after all of those got resolved, I was genuinely shocked to see that the game didn't spontaneously explode or something. In fact, it even claimed to be rendering frames. But taking a peek at the frame buffer, it quickly became clear that all those frames were pitch black. I traced through the logic of the emulator a bit, and after a bit more debugging, I found that the flags for the picture processing unit never even got touched. To debug a port like this, your best bet is to print some output from your program and compare it to the original. What you're seeing here is a log of the bytes being read from the Super Mario Bros. ROM and the address that each one was read from. Comparing it side by side with the original emulator like this helps me find exactly where the emulation takes a wrong step. In this case, we can see that the address from which we're reading the opcode jumps to the wrong value and... Oh, what's an opcode, you ask? Put simply, the CPU inside of the NES, the legendary 6502, works kind of like a tape reader. It reads one byte at a time, processes the instruction associated with it, then moves the program counter forward to either get some value for the current instruction or to get the next instruction. Of course, I'm definitely oversimplifying this, and I'm not exactly qualified to talk about the intricacies of the 6502, but this should at least help you understand what's going wrong. Some instruction is telling the NES to change the address that it's reading from. But our emulated CPU messes this up and lands on the wrong address, which usually gets it stuck in some infinite loop. Now, there were several such bugs, so I'll skip the details for brevity. Most of them came from, who'd have guessed it, bugs I introduced while porting from C to Squirrel. While resolving these, I ran into a bit of good news and some bad news. The good news was that the emulator was getting further and further into the Super Mario Bros. Program before deviating. But the bad news is that the log was now too long to look through manually. This is where diffing becomes useful. If you have two text files that are supposed to be identical, like the logs of the same NES emulator written in two different languages, you can use a tool such as the Unix diff to tell you exactly where the two logs start to desync. Even then, the discrepancies aren't trivial to debug. Even if I know in roughly which part of the code the issue is happening and have the original side by side with my port, it's still never immediately obvious. Eventually, I got to the point where all the instructions were being handled correctly, and I even got it to draw something to the screen, but it's not exactly looking too much like Mario. The problem was that the rendering of each frame was offset by a few cycles. The picture processing unit of the NES runs 3 times faster than the CPU, and as soon as it's done processing the whole frame buffer, it updates a few values that may be used in further calculations. If the rendering routine isn't perfectly in sync, the processor falls out of sync too. This offset would then accumulate over time, eventually driving the emulator off course. At first, I assumed that it must have been some silly typo, like a +3 to the cycle count instead of +2 by sheer accident. But either way, seeing as how the emulator worked fine otherwise, surely it couldn't have been a fundamental flaw, right? When I wrote the functions that would mask all of the 32-bit integers down to 8 or 16 bits, I had to skim through the code to add these functions to each assignment operation. An assignment like this would become this. An addition like this would become this. And most importantly, increment and decrement operations such as these ones would end up looking like these. Here's some homework for those of you who write code. What's the difference between these two operations? Got your answers ready? Okay, so unless you've only ever written Python, you might know that this is called the post-increment operator. The one major difference that sets it apart from similar operations is that it only increments the variable after returning it. So, say x is equal to 2. After a post-increment, its value will be 3. But here's the catch. If you try to use the value of x++, it'll still be 2. This is a subtle difference, and most experienced programmers will keep this in mind while writing code. But here's the thing, I wasn't writing code, I was translating it. So while mindlessly wrapping these values, I accidentally swapped all post-increment operators with a regular increment. This meant that I would exit some loops one iteration early, simply because the value would get checked after it was decremented. So that's how I ended up desynced by a few PPU cycles each tick. I also ran into some similar bugs related to operator precedence. See, Squirrel doesn't have shorthands for bitwise assignments. In other words, I can't do x and equal 8, for example. I have to do x equals x and 8, which in this case is still identical. But if the expression was more complicated, just transforming it to this is no longer identical, as x and y bind tighter than y XOR 12. Anyway, with all that out of the way, the emulator starts rendering its first recognizable frame. Well, recognizable is about as far as it goes currently. It might be hard to tell what's going on for the low resolution in-game display, so here's a direct dump of the frame buffer. The sprites are all there, but the colors are off. Mario seems to be looking fine, but everything else looks green. Or maybe blue. And actually, that would be a pretty good guess at what's really happening. Since Mario is fine, the issue is likely isolated to just the background sprites, and since everything seems to be tinted green or blue, we can start to suspect that the background is just missing the red color channel entirely. If we grab the hex color values for the title box and compare them to the original emulator, we see that... Nope, never mind. It's close, but not quite. I really thought I was onto something. Once again, to debug this, I had both emulators spit out a bunch of debug information, this time from the background rendering procedure of the PPU, and diffed it all to isolate the issue. It turns out there was exactly one variable in the smallness source code that wasn't an 8 or 16-bit unsigned integer, but rather a good old classic 32-bit signed int. I was unnecessarily masking it to 16 bits, and after changing that one line of code, I had finally achieved full parity with the smallness emulator. Alright, let's take a step back for a bit and look at the Portal 2 side of things. Other than porting an emulator from C to Squirrel, what do you have to do to make it actually show up in-game? The obvious first concern is the display. With just Squirrel alone, we can't create a custom screen with our own frame buffer. This is a scripting language after all, so I can only really use it to script the behavior of in-game entities. In this case, I'm creating a large grid of self-illuminated cubes and updating their color every time that a new frame is ready. Because of the 2048 entity limit, I can't actually represent the entire NES screen. That's why the resolution is so bad. I'm only able to render every 7th pixel without crashing the game. But the display is only half the battle. Running the emulator itself isn't as straightforward as you think. When running a script, the whole engine pauses to wait for that script to finish executing. If we just ran the emulator indefinitely, we would lock up the game. Valve foresaw something like this, which is why they implemented an exception which prevents any script query from running longer than 30 milliseconds. Thanks, Valve, that's great and all, but this quickly becomes a pain to work around. Sure, either way, we'd have to segment the main program loop across multiple game ticks. This way, we can emulate just a few CPU cycles of the NES each tick, and return control to Portal 2 for the rest of the frame. But unless we know how long any given iteration will take ahead of time, we always run the risk of going over those 30 milliseconds, which abruptly halts the emulator and desyncs it. Too many iterations and the risk is too high. Too few iterations and we're wasting potential emulation time during less demanding cycles. The best way I've found to work around this is to spin up a new script VM for each CPU cycle. Yes, this introduces a ton of overhead, but the 30 millisecond limit only applies to individual queries. So really, I can keep the game busy for however long I like, as long as I'm actively starting new script VMs. And with this comes our final technical problem. The emulator currently runs at about 5 seconds per frame. That's a fifth of 1 FPS. Sorry for the colors, by the way, I recorded this demo before I found the fix to that, and I didn't bother re-recording, because this little sped up clip took me half an hour to record, and it doesn't even look that good with the low resolution. Although, hold on. What if we just skip processing the pixels that we're not displaying? Since the entity limit only allows us to display every 7th pixel anyway, why waste the time calculating all the pixels that we don't get to see? With this optimization, we're now looking at right about 1.3 FPS. If you're keeping track, that's over 6 times faster than before. But since we're brute forcing way past that 30 millisecond script timeout, Portal 2 isn't feeling so good anymore. The game that all of this is running on is itself running at barely 2 frames per second. The more time we give to the emulator, the less time Portal 2 has to render its frames. If only there was a way to separate the game server from the client. Oh, right. Co-op exists. By hosting a Portal 2 co-op game on one computer and connecting to it from another, we can have the host bear the cost of running the emulator, while the other player can enjoy a smooth frame rate alongside an almost recognizable Super Mario Bros. But at this point, I think I really have played all of my cards. I tried building a standalone Squirrel runtime, the same version that Portal 2 uses, to test how well the emulator would run without any overhead. But even that clocks in at only about 3.3 frames per second on the title screen. Squirrel just isn't comparable to C in terms of raw performance, not even close. It's a language made for lightweight scripting, and I don't think anyone ever imagined it would be running an emulator. That said, I would have loved to find a more practical application for this, but given the quality and performance of emulating just the original Super Mario Bros., I don't think this is worth much more than a simple tech demo. Feel free to prove me wrong in the comments. Anyway, if you subscribe, I might tell you about the time I turned Portal 2 into a Minecraft client. Otherwise, that's all from me today. See ya!